apologies to parents. We have two family members whose adult sons and daughter receive support services from our service providers. These parents have been actively involved in the advancement of IDD issues for many years. Please welcome David Graves. He is the parent of someone with a developmental disability, and he would like to offer some brief remarks about the importance of establishing trust between direct support professionals and the people they serve.
Marsha, our son Alex, in support of our daughter Elizabeth, who is fortunately also here with us today. Elizabeth, coincidentally, on Saturday, is going to celebrate her 30th birthday. For 25 years, we were able to care for Elizabeth in our home. Elizabeth has cerebral palsy, and until that care was provided until it became logistically and physically impossible to continue. Fortunately, we found an agency called Opportunities Unlimited based in Cranston. And through Opportunities, we were able to place Elizabeth in an apartment staffed 24 hours a day by what we believe to be qualified staff, highly qualified staff. Unfortunately, Elizabeth requires assistance to do the most basic of needs. She needs help eating, she needs help bathing, she needs help clothing herself. In fact, she needs assistance with the most intimate of personal activities. In order to do that, again, you have to have qualified staff, people who are prepared, trained, and ready to continue to deliver that assistance. As you might imagine, the nature of this care requires the development of trust between the recipient and the provider. When someone is picking you up, carrying you, putting you to bed, placing you on the toilet, you're wondering, is this person qualified? Is this person capable of carrying me? And again, the only way you can establish that trust is over time. That requires, again, the retention of qualified staff over a long period of time. It's becoming apparently more and more difficult to find that type of staff because of funding issues associated with funding programs for people with intellectual and disabilities. Just as an aside, my wife's sister-in-law was a special education teacher in Maine. And many years ago, she told us how fortunate we were to be living in Rhode Island, because Rhode Island was the model for funding for programs for people with intellectual disabilities and developmental disabilities. Again, that was many years ago. For 15 years now, there's been flat funding for these programs. There's been no increase in funding, while at the same time, there's been a mandated increase in the minimum wage. There's also been an increase in the operating expenses for these agencies. The final insult, and I call it an insult, is the proposal to cut $18 million in funding for these agencies. Already heard, this funding places a large number of our fellow Rhode Islanders in physical and emotional jeopardy. So we're here today to talk to our legislatures and ask them to do the right thing, to protect the most vulnerable among us, to provide funding that will allow these agencies to carry out the missions to which they are so dedicated, and perhaps even to once again make Rhode Island a model for caring and compassion in this country. Thank you.